didn't see Shamrock's hand or whatever, like get the arm up and whatnot. They had Severn kind of turn heel with Owen for a little while. So he was kind of like helping Owen in the SummerSlam match. So he kind of turned heel again. But then they have another idea about turning Shamrock heel. Do you think that was a wise move to be thinking about Shamrock going heel? Or do you think that sort of damaged him around this point, Matt? Would you have kept him as a babyface at this time?
Yeah, I mean, he was working consistently well as a face. You know, I would not have changed that. I thought he was coming across quite well at the time. I would have been under the impression of, like, if he isn't broke, why fix it, you know? Perhaps they thought they could squeeze something else out of him, or a new sort of personality or dynamic that people might get into, but I think it was working fine the way they were going with him.
Sure, yeah, no, I totally agree with that. Okay, so I want to basically hit on maybe a little bit further. We're gonna push forward now. This is because basically Shamrock's have like he's a little bit out anyway because of the injuries and stuff around this time. But I'm going to go straight now to the 12th of October 1998 from the Raw tapings. They announced Triple H has been stripped of the Intercontinental Championship due to the 30-day rule, Matt. that changes whenever it wants to, doesn't it? And had and they had a one-night tournament on the show consisting of all single bouts. Shamrock beat Steve Blackman in 2 minutes 29 seconds with a knee submission. The gimmick being Steve Blackman's knee still wasn't ready, so they're trying to sell that. X-Pac beat Mankind in 3 minutes 15 seconds with a schoolboy after Shamrock hit Mankind in an ankle with the ankle with a chair. Shamrock then put the another submission, which was basically a different form of an armbar, on X-Pac for a long time. They were going to award the title to Shamrock, on a forfeit. But X-Pac instead, they do a match and screamed "Ring the Bell." So this seemed like they were trying to recreate the whole screw job at this point, Matt. It's not unheard of at this time, considering the amount of times they used it over the years after the infamous screw job business, of course. Meltzer reports the two had a good match, ending with Shamrock using the ankle lock submission just under 4 minutes to win the title. X-Pac had a bloody nose. Both X-Pac and Shamrock came off really good throughout the tournament, with both hard-working guys. Shamrock is making an even better heel than I thought, Meltzer reports. They'll probably do some sort of angle when Triple H is present. Shamrock obviously takes the belt to the next pay-per-view. So he becomes the Intercontinental Champion, Matt. This is, you know, this is Shamrock's first title that he's picked up since he's, you know, began in the WWF. What do you make of the way they did that, Matt? Obviously, you know, Triple H is stripped. They do a tournament. Is that a good way? I mean, it seems like they want to do the theme of the tournament because of Shamrock's paths, and, you know, he can win these things because of the UFC. So they seem like they heavily want to keep telling people that he can win these kind of single bouts and get to a finals and do the job. What did you make of the first win on his first singles title, Matt?
Well, yeah, I remember at the time when I was watching it, I'm always kind of a fan of the sort of tournament structure anyway. I do think it adds a little bit more excitement to it.
Sure.
So, you know, just as a fan on that standpoint, I do like that kind of scenario. But yeah, I can see, like, they were really trying to build a name for Shamrock in that kind of thing, like we saw when we were talking a little while ago about the King of the Ring and how he did it there, and, you know, it comes back to it again at this moment here. I just so surprised it took this long to get to this moment anyway. You know, this felt like something that should have been done in the first few months with him arriving into the company, you know. Sure. So just that's the only real surprise to me here, is that it's taken so long to get to this point.
Yeah, no, I agree. Yeah, it's interesting he's won his first one there. Okay, I want to go to the next pay-per-view now, which is Judgment Day. different times of the years to where we remember Judgment Day being, but yeah, we are here. And it's Ken Shamrock up against Mankind, and he retains the Intercontinental Championship in a match just under 15 minutes. Meltzer reports Shamrock worked a real legit offensive style, early working on the leg with a lot of knee and leg kicks. His stuff was good, but not a lot of reaction to it. Even if Mankind probably is the most sympathetic babyface character in the company this week, now that Shamrock is a heel, he's about 3 to 5 months away from really being possibly one of the biggest heels in the company, Meltzer reports here. And yeah, I mean, he actually rates the match just a 3.5, so it's not a bad score at all. I mean, he really rates this match as a decent thing. It's an interesting dynamic between Mankind and Shamrock. And yeah, I'd recommend people to go back and check that out. It's a pretty good match, actually. I kind of enjoyed that. It was number 7 as well. I think that went on just before the main event. So Shamrock as the Intercontinental Champion is, he's like, you know, being positioned as the number 2 semi sort of main event. I think it's worth pointing out as well that back then that the semi main event was quite a big deal, whereas today it's not so much considered. It doesn't really matter where you are on the card, it seems today. You could be anywhere, but back then it kind of did make a big deal where you were positioned on a card. Okay, I want to jump now to the 19th of October. This is from Milwaukee, and X-Pac pins Ken Shamrock in just over 4 minutes with a face buster after Mankind distracted Shamrock in a non-title match. also around this time, there's a house shows going on in MSG. They're having triple threat intercontinental matches. Shamrock beats not only he beats Vader and Mankind that week, which is interesting. A week later, the plot of the movie Champions, starring Shamrock, which we spoke about earlier, is about a UFC champion who retired when the sport was outlawed, but after his brother died in an underground match, he has to return to face a foe of the ultimate battle to death, Matt. There you go. If that gets anybody, if that gets any, I can think of somebody that would enjoy a film like that. I can assure you. Probably see that next week now. Yeah, check that one out then. If that gets your blood going, if you're into those kind of things, you'll probably enjoy that. Okay, on house shows, a little bit further on into October, Rock has, he is known as The Rock at this point, is beating Ken Shamrock in DQs at this point. And now I want to go to the Raw. Now we're getting into November. We're in Dallas at this point. The major contracts that will come due in 1999 at this point are... and now this is very, very interesting because obviously everybody knows the Monday Night War saw lots of guys go from each other's promotions. So it was like our equivalent of like soccer, football. It's like a transfer window, isn't it, Matt? It's like people just were going everywhere. And, you know, you didn't know who was going to turn up on what show sometimes. And this was definitely like that. So, yeah, it's worth pointing out that the people that were going to be coming up in the end of 99, which of course was only a year later, were The Giant, Rick and Scott Steiner, Dean Malenko, Chris Jericho, Chris Benoit, Rey Mysterio Jr., Ken Shamrock, Jeff Jarrett and Hunter Hearst Helmsley, of all people there, Matt. We're all coming to a head in 1999 with their contracts. Of those, Shamrock can't jump if he were to decide to, which odds are extremely large he wouldn't, because his contract has an option clause which means if the WWF wanted to renew him with a raise built into his renewal, McMahon has the option. Shamrock has talked about returning to the UFC for a fight or two, most likely with McMahon's blessing if he can get it. So, yeah, Shamrock would be turning 35 in February of the following year, and he's got a fighting, he's obviously got fighting in his blood, and whether he wants to go back to UFC is another thing. So, Matt, at this point, we're at the end of 1998. Do you feel like, from what we're getting, that Shamrock still has a little bit of an itch to get back to UFC at this point, as far as his fighting career goes?
Yeah, I imagine that as like a natural competitive fighter, you know, that will always be part of him, you know, and it's, I would have hazarded a guess that he would have been missing it, you know, because it's just the competition, isn't it? And the probably the thrill you get of that and actually the accomplishment. I think, yeah, a lot of people in the UFC do have that kind of thing. We've seen it with Brock Lesnar, for instance, haven't we? That although he can come back to the WWE and like compete on the highest level and get paid ridiculous amounts of money, he still feels like he has something to prove to himself, you know, that he can go into that ring and still into the octagon and still dominate there.
Absolutely, yeah. So it seems like WWF are a little bit, you know, apprehensive of where he wants to go, and maybe there's like a little bit of issues with loyalty on both parts there, on the whole push. Okay, I want to bring us up now to Survivor Series 1998 here. Of course, for people that are not familiar with that, this is the night they kind of had The Rock. He was the people's champ, and then all of a sudden he's the corporate champ. I'm sure you'll remember this one, Matt, where they have another tournament going on here. And it's interesting because, you know, every tournament that there's been like this, Shamrock has been pretty dominant. Shamrock this night, this is for like the WWF title. Shamrock is beating Goldust in like the first round, and then he's going to get a match with The Rock. And, you know, their feud, I mean, it's been like over a whole year really, Matt, hasn't it? Between Rocky Maivia and The Rock or whatever against Shamrock. Seems like it's gone throughout the year. So it combines with Rock beating Shamrock in just over 8 minutes. And, of course, this was the whole double turn kind of thing. Like, nobody was supposed to see it coming. When the whole Boss Man comes out and, you know, chucks in the nightstick and Boss Man, you know, interrupted the whole thing and sort of gave Rock the victory. And, you know, I think the rest is history there. You get The Rock, who's a new corporate champ, the corporate elbow and all the rest of it. What did you make of that whole setup, Matt? Was you surprised that they would use Shamrock again in that kind of thing, that they didn't want to protect him a little bit? Or is that just, you know, was that always the norm? And I guess in a lot of ways, you know, Shamrock wasn't too hard done by because of the whole DQ ending at the end of it. But, you know, the way it was, Matt, I mean, if you think about it, Shamrock was playing the heel in all this at this point. The Rock was getting the mild, or I'd say actually more than mild, but he was getting over with the fans. And then, of course, they wanted to pull the rug from underneath everybody's feet and, you know, say, hang on a minute, he's the corporate champ after all, you know. Die, Rocky, die was never forgotten. What did you make of that whole setup at Survivor Series, Matt?
Well, I guess, like, for Shamrock, it was another one of those situations where he always comes so close and then, like, always yet so far.
Mm-hmm.
Because although he was a good option to choose for this and someone, I suppose, at the time a lot of people would believe in and think, you know, like, as you said, like, with his tournament background, this would be like a great kind of situation for him to go on and maybe capture this, like, but I guess they went into this whole thing like probably like for months ahead of this. We're just thinking, okay, we need a way to really run with The Rock now, like he's gonna be our guy.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess they just came into this like full steam with that mindset, and almost anything else like they might have thought about Shamrock at the time might have been purely secondary, like, and this whole thing was probably just set up purely just for The Rock, I imagine.
Yeah, no, I think you're right. Meltzer gives this match just a 2.5 stars, probably because of the ending. So, of course, this is their, like, fourth match pay-per-view.